awesome day. I hope everyone has enjoyed being at Young Explorers South Australia round two, year two. On behalf of SAP, I would just like to thank everyone for spending so much time and effort on your awesome ICT projects. They're absolutely wonderful. All the judges, by all accounts, had an amazing day. And now we have a lovely keynote speaker for you, Imogen Lowe, who was an ex-Young ICT Explorers winner and also an intern at SAP in Brisbane.
What do you want to be when you grow up? What do you want to be?
You.
A teacher. Excellent choice. What do you want to be? What do you want to be?
A scientist.
A scientist. Anyone else? What do you want to be?
An architect.
That's excellent. Well, when I was growing up, I knew exactly what I wanted to become. I wanted to become a dragon. A green one. I could breathe fire. Now, after I realized that this probably wasn't a very realistic goal, I settled on second best, which would be to become some kind of medical practitioner. Mainly because it's what all of my uncles and aunties do. And I went through my entire schooling, sure, that is what I would become. Never would I have aspired to study computer science or work in a software company or write code for a living. I mean, nobody in my family codes. The only languages that they know are the ones that you speak. Besides, a job as a programmer sounds kind of technical and boring. It's really only good for like introverted, mathematical, nerdy boys with their names all their life. So, how on earth did I end up doing exactly that? In grade 11, my IT teacher introduced me to the Young ICT Explorers competition. And at least from what I understood, you just had to build something really cool with technology, and you could win an iPod. We were learning a little bit of HTML and CSS at school, so I decided to build a website for a local Pilates business. Oh, I probably invested the majority of my holidays into building a thing by collaborating with the business owner and implementing really tricky features and making it look absolutely perfect. I really wanted to win that iPod. And by the end of it, I felt pretty proud of my work and felt fairly optimistic pitching at the event. I think my teacher secretly had higher ups too. But by the end of it, I hadn't received anything more than, oh yeah, that looks cool, from one of the judges. That felt like the worst day ever. All of that time and effort and no iPod. It dawned on me the following year in grade 12 that if I was to have any chance of winning this iPod, I needed a serious shift in my approach. Instead of thinking, what can I build with technology? I needed to question, what problems can I solve? And should they be solved with technology? I realized that it's one thing to be able to write code, but it's what you actually write with the code that makes all the difference. Who here has ever found themselves on a large campus or a complex multi-level facility beyond hope as to how to get to your next destination? Whether you're in a shopping center, or a hospital, or a university campus, or a school campus, an airport, IKEA. How do we usually approach this problem? You know, sometimes we walk around a bit, look for some signs. If we're really desperate, we might start tapping unsuspecting strangers on the shoulder. But wouldn't it be so much easier if we could simply pull out one of those internet-connected supercomputers that we all carry around in our back pocket and Google directions? These are the kinds of lines that I was thinking along when I envisioned an interactive 3D map of my high school campus, which could run across any device in any web browser and could be accessed online via a simple Google search query. Now, when you adopt this kind of problem-first thinking, you quickly realize that you probably don't have all the tools necessary to solve the problem out of the box. For me, I knew how to build a website, but I definitely did not know how to build what I had in mind. In fact, start. But I really wanted that iPod, so I got started anyway. I don't want to bore you with the technical details, so I'll put it this way. In the startup world, we hear a lot about the importance of failure. Fail fast and fail often, as they say. I guess I didn't really appreciate the importance of this until I embarked on the development of my product. A lot of late nights, failed attempts, and technology just fall apart. And not to mention, the more developers I spoke to, the more convinced I was that what I was trying to build simply was not possible. And it didn't help that something kept reminding me that I hadn't even come close to receiving recognition at the previous event. I was starting to believe that this whole YICTE thing just wasn't meant to be. At that point, I could have thrown in the towel and given up for good, but I had a really wonderful IT teacher. I'm not sure he completely believed it was possible to build what I had in mind. He even told me that it would probably fail, but reassured me that was okay, and encouraged me to keep trying anyway. In fact, he even went to the extent of loosening up the constraints of the assignment that the idea stemmed out of to allow for much more creativity. As you would know, school assignments are typically very rigorous in nature. You're usually not allowed to just go off and dream up your own project. But when my teacher saw my growing interest in indoor mapping, he offered me the opportunity to continue to explore the idea, despite it not being specifically outlined anywhere on the task sheet. And that freedom to think innovatively and interdependently within an environment where I could take risks without fearing failure was absolutely awesome. And without it, I may have completely missed the opportunity to discover what I really love to do and where I can best contribute. Wish all assignments were like that. That year, I entered the competition again with a solution that surprisingly worked. And this time around, I had much better luck. Funnily enough, after all that, I switched iPods off to cash prizes. But, man, I can't even begin to tell you how invaluable the internship SAP offered me has been so far. I thought an internship meant just collecting copies and printing stuff, especially when I just out of school. But I've really been given the freedom to get involved in anything that interests me, which is great, but it means that I come to the office a lot more than I should, because there's just so much cool technology that I need to get my hands on. But never in a million years could I have anticipated the places that this map that I was building would take me to. After it also won a Queensland I Award and a National I Award, this same map that I built in high school took me on a sponsored trip to Taiwan, where it represented Australia at the Asia Pacific YICTE Alliance Awards. And wasn't that an eye-opening experience? Essentially, I got to spend a week immersed amongst some of the most innovative ideas in Asia Pacific. And if the ideas coming out of there are a representation of the technological advances we will see in the next 5 years or so, then it's hard not to feel very excited in the future. And almost a little frightened. Take a radiologist, for example. You're the doctor who specializes in reading x-rays and MRI scans. Well, radiologists require a tremendous amount of training, typically a minimum of 13 years after school. But what I saw in Taiwan was a prototype of artificial intelligence which had trained itself to diagnose these diseases faster and more accurately than any human radiologist ever could. Even while working at SAP, I have seen firsthand how organizations are collecting incomprehensible amounts of information about nearly every aspect of their operations. And a great number of human tasks are encapsulated in that data. And we take that data and we run these algorithms over that data to teach the computer how to perform those human tasks all by itself. But maybe even more frightening was the 3D printer that I saw. that didn't just print prototypes or spare parts. It prepared and printed your dinner. Well, a sample of steak that I saw, that wasn't slaughtered from an animal. It was artificially grown by scientists in a laboratory. Yuck. In this world of technology, you, as the next generation of graduates, will have career opportunities that we can only imagine. And while exciting, it can make it seem almost impossible to prepare you to compete in the job market of the future. We will always need great doctors and teachers and engineers, but even these more traditional career paths, we need agile, creative minds to constantly adapt to our ever-changing and unpredictable technological advances. And we need innovators to keep progressing forward. So I challenge you, instead of thinking, what do I want to be when I grow up? Start flexing your entrepreneurial muscles by thinking, what problems do I want to solve? And how am I going to do it? I wish you all the best of luck as we have to see you later.